Hello and welcome everybody. This is section 6 of the notes, and here we are going to discuss local polynomial regression. And I'll show you that the generalization of the Nadaraya-Watson estimator from the previous section and the local polynomials which we will introduce here, they will allow to match a slope or maybe even curvature of the data close to where we are estimating. And this can lead to slightly more accurate estimates. So that's the aim, and we are going to do that in three parts. Namely, first, I tell you a bit about just usual linear regression with weights. Then I'll tell you a bit about fitting polynomials to data. And then finally, I'll show you how to combine these two ingredients to do local polynomial regression. Okay, so regression with weights first. So linear regression with weights is a generalization of linear regression where you give different weight to the individual observations. So before we minimized the residual sum of squares, that is for every data point, how far away is the regression line from the data. And the idea here is just we don't want to count all the points the same. Later we will count points which are close to a given location stronger and points which are far away less strongly. So what we do is now we do Rw of beta. It's the same thing, but every observation has a weight wi. Good, and that just in addition to what we had before needs weights w1 up to wn, which are positive, and one could require that the weights sum to 1, but we will see in a few minutes that does not actually matter, so I just write positive here. Good, now we need to do the same game as before. We need to minimize the residual sum of squares, and the trick here is again to use vector notation. And what we can do here is we can write epsilon hat transpose W epsilon hat, where W is a diagonal matrix which has just W1 up to Wn, the weights on the diagonal. So if you check what happens, if we do W times epsilon hat, then we get a vector which has W1 times epsilon hat 1 is the first entry, and all the way down up to Wn times epsilon hat n is the last entry. And if we multiply that from the left with epsilon hat transpose, then we get that expression. So that's just clever notation for this sum. Good, and now we need to find the beta which minimizes the thing. And to make that possible, we need to see how does that depend on beta. And the answer is, as it was before, epsilon hat is x beta minus y. So we get this transpose w x beta minus y. And the minimization is also the same as before. So we can take derivatives and we set all of these derivatives equal to 0. Then we know we have an extremum, and from looking at it like this, we already see that thing is positive, so it must look like a parabola, so the extremum will be a minimum automatically, or we can just check second derivatives. So question is, what is the beta derivative of this expression? And we can do that exactly as we did it in lemma 2.1 of the level 3 notes. So what we did there was first expand the two brackets, so we get beta transpose x transpose w x beta minus 2 times beta transpose x transpose w y plus y transpose w y. And first observation, as before, that term does not depend on beta, so when we take derivatives that will not contribute anything. Maybe I shouldn't wipe it out. It is still there, but it does not contribute to the derivative. And then we did the proper rules before. I write just gradient Rw beta for the vector of all partial derivatives. And here we get 2x transpose Wx beta. I'm not showing the calculation here. It is literally like in lemma 2.1, only with x transpose x replaced with x transpose Wx, but we never touch this matrix in the derivation, so it's just copy that into the other argument. And then the middle term is minus 2 x transpose wy. And if you're unsure about the gradient, that is the vector of all partial derivatives, Then you can just do it component by component as we did it in the lemma 2.1 before. Good, and now if we set this equal to 0, then we can bring that one to the other side, cancel the twos, and get x transpose w x beta equals x transpose w y, and then we get the formula I wrote in the notes, namely beta hat, our estimator, is the solution of that and is x transpose w x inverse x transpose w y. And as a quick plausibility check, if we set wi equals 1, then that expression turns into the old residual sum of squares, so we should get the same result. And in this case, w is the identity matrix, and indeed we get x transpose x, with the identity the w just disappeared, inverse x transpose, this disappears too, so it's just x transpose y, so we get x transpose x inverse x transpose y, which was the formula we had before. So that's indeed consistent with the previous result. Good, so that is how we fit a model with weights, and the important thing to keep in mind is that only affects the fitting procedure, so we found now a different regression line, which is better where the weights are so large, but is worse where the weights are smaller, because we counted less of that. But it is still a regression line, so all the other formulas don't grow additional betas. So fitted values are still x beta hat, so there is no w here. We just computed beta hat in a different way, but we use the same models then. And if we make predictions, the predicted mean at x triddle 1 up to x triddle p, we find, as we did before, as beta hat 0 plus beta hat 1 times x triddle 1 up to beta hat p x triddle p, and again there is no weights anywhere here, so the only new thing was we compute beta hat in a different way, so that we could write as x triddle transpose beta hat, if we take this to be the vector which is 1 x1 triddle up to xp triddle. Good, so that was regression with weights, and in the next video I'll show you how to fit polynomials rather than straight lines to data. So see you soon.